Hey everybody, welcome to the Ronline Report. Today's guests, that's plural, we have Akim the Beast Wiliams and his new coach, Justin Miller, joining us from the fine states of New York and New Jersey, respectively. I think I got that right. So please welcome Akim and Justin. How are you guys?
Pretty good.
How are you?
Excellent. Yeah. So where to begin, man? Akim, last year, 2020, was an excellent year for you. It was your second pro win of your career. You defeated Justin Rodriguez, who was no joke. That was not easy to do. Got the Chicago pro win and then go to the Olympia. And dude, you know, we talk about leveling. We use that word leveling up a lot lately, but you really did level up because the potential that we've been seeing in you for so long, now it's really starting to bloom. Top six at the Olympia. That's the coveted spot. That's where everybody wants to be, is top five, top six, because that's the very top. You don't want to be 12th, 15th, 16th. And, you know, a lot of people are starting to really believe in you as a future Mr. Olympia champion. Whereas a few years ago, if you had asked that, they'd say, I don't know. You know, he's got a great shape and structure. He's massive, but I don't know if he could be Mr. Olympia. But now I think a lot of people are really coming around to the fact that you have that potential in you to become Mr. Olympia. So let's start, Justin. I want to ask you, you've been around this New York, New Jersey bodybuilding scene for many, many years. When did you first become aware of Akim?
I've known him for years. You know, I've been a fan of his. I followed him as an amateur, you know, as a pro. I've known him for a long time. Just like, you know, casually, like, hi and bye, what's up, how you doing type of thing. But, you know, I've gotten to know him a lot more lately. And like you said, man, Akim is really an amazing talent. He's ready to do big, big things in the sport.
Yeah. I want a couple stories from the early days of Akim that I love these. There's two stories I love. And the first one is when Akim first started training. Akim, it was at your college gym, right? And you weren't that big. You were like 170, 180 when you started training?
No, actually it was 147, 146.
Oh, goodness. Same. You weren't 4'11" back then, were you?
No.
So tell us a story about how you got really strong before you got really big. And you actually became stronger than the biggest, strongest guy in the gym within just a couple months. Can you tell me that story?
I mean, the reason I remember my weight is that was the last time I had to do a physical to get cleared to play sports, to play basketball.
Wow.
So, but I weighed very well. I think I was 146. That was the last time I went to got a physical to get cleared to play ball. After I finished training, a buddy of mine, he was going into the Marines, and he was going to drop out of college and go into the Marines. So he wanted to get in shape and everything like that. And, you know, being, you know, playing basketball and getting on the sideline and everything like that, I wanted to give, you know, weight training a try. And me and him, we started working out and everything like that. And there was a big guy in the gym named CJ. He was the man in the gym, you know. He was big. He had some muscle on him. And he was, like, the number one bencher in the gym. And within, like, you could say a couple months, I was actually benching him.
It was 405, right?
Yeah, I did 405 once. He was stuck at, like, I think it was 375.
Oh, wow.
And I did 405. And everybody, like, people couldn't stop talking shit.
Because you were, what were you, like, 180, 190 at the time?
I was up to, like, maybe, like, 175, maybe.
Oh, geez. And what do you think he weighed, CJ?
He had to be about, like, 280.
Oh, my goodness. So, come on. You made him look terrible. But, you know, Justin, obviously, everything has to start with genetics. All the champions have to have that to begin with, the genetic potential to be a champion. You sent me a picture the other day from Akim when he was competing in natural shows. And man, I know a lot of guys that have been on gear for many, many years that look nothing like that. So when you see a picture like that, what does that tell you?
Tells me that he has the potential to be Mr. Olympia, you know? I've been around the sport a long time, Ron. You know, we've been around this thing for forever. And, you know, I'm not prepared to say that I've ever met anybody that has better genetics than Akim does, you know. Just in learning more about him over the last couple months, it's just the more I learn about him, honestly, the more impressed I am. The more I see how I see the changes in his body in just a short time, you know. Akim is the real deal.
Yeah, you know, at that Olympia, Rami made almost everybody look tiny, but he didn't make Akim look tiny. I think, you know, Rami was obviously like 285, 290, something like that. Akim, what did you weigh at that last Olympia?
I want to say I was around maybe like 265, probably.
Yeah. And you, Rami and you, are you about the same height, or is he taller? It's hard to say. So, because you're, what are you, about 5'10"?
Yeah, we're about the same height.
Yeah, he's about the same height. I hear so many different heights for Rami. It's ridiculous. Everything from like 5'9 to 6 foot. Come on, guys. Pick up.
About 5'10".
Okay. So tell me about what it felt like to finally get, you know, I think you were in the very first call out, weren't you?
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, that had to be a groundbreaking moment for you after all these years, because you've been to the Olympia before, but you've never been in the first call out. This had to tell you something was different about that year and that show.
I mean, going into that show, I actually said it before we at the Olympia and everything. Like, I told everybody I'm coming and I'm getting the first call out.
Yeah.
Like, I actually said it on camera and everything like that in a couple of interviews that I did. Because I, you know, being inside the hotel and posing and seeing what you look like, I knew I brought the package that would allow me to get into the first call. After the first call out, I really didn't know what was going to happen, but I know I brought enough to get me into that first call out.
Yeah. Justin, were you at the show? I can't remember. It's just a blur.
I was at the show, yeah.
Yeah. What were you thinking when you were watching him up on the judging?
I was sitting front and center. I mean, you know, look, it's an opinion-based sport, right? But I had him even a little higher.
Hmm. Yeah.
You know, I like his physique better than a couple of the guys that were ahead of him, but he certainly belonged in that top group.
Yeah. And I know, Justin, you're super critical, and that's a good coach. Doesn't just tell you how awesome they are. That's a pretty crappy coach, actually, when you think about it. Those are the bodybuilders that never get any better, because, you know, coach says you're perfect. So when you look at Akim's physique, and that was his most recent show, give me the strong points and give me the things that you saw that this could be improved, and then he would move up even higher.
I mean, you know, it's like any bodybuilder, you're looking at this, the strengths and weaknesses, and I think that Akim's pretty complete, to be honest. Mm-hmm. But there's a couple spots that I thought that could be a little better. You know, one of the things was the main thing, I guess. I mean, if you could pick out a weakness on him, his back could be a little bit better.
Yeah.
You know, it's good already, but it, you know, and what I came up with was have him come to Bev's and train with George.
George, that's what I wanted to get into. George, the bull, Pete, the bull, Peterson, the third best. I think that's the best back in the sport right now. That's my opinion.
Underrated back, but especially like, when he's not having to make a weight cap in off season and stuff, George is very, very strong, trains very hard. And I thought it would be a good matchup, you know. Similarly for George, I wanted to get him out more to New Jersey to work on leg training with Akim.
Yeah.
So like George's legs could come up a notch, you know. We did it once, so we're gonna work at doing it some more. But Akeem's been coming out every week. And it's been going great. I mean, he's made huge improvements in the last couple of months.
Yeah.
You know, but yeah, you know, I, like I said, I really believe that he's going to be the next Mr. Olympia. And I see it. I see it on a daily and on a weekly basis. You know, I see the improvements coming along, and it doesn't change my mind. It only solidifies what I thought originally.
So Akim, tell me about training with George, back training. How is it different from what you had been doing for the last, I don't know, year or two?
I mean, one thing I would say about Justin, he preaches conditioning a lot. Mm. Like, you know, getting ready, just starting prep and everything like that. Like every week, you know, I would look better, but he's just like, nah, I want you conditioned. I want you to see you more conditioned. So just getting that in my head, you know, just making me feel like, okay, you got to raise the bar, you know, you can't settle.
Yeah.
You know, so that definitely just hearing him say that in the back of my mind just motivates me every time to just like just keep pushing the bar and just keep trying to go further into that whole like conditioning realm, you know?
Yeah.
But back to your question, yeah. And with George, I've been a great, you know, when it comes to chest, legs and everything like that, but I've never had a mind to muscle connection when it comes to training my back.
Hmm.
Like some guys, you know, they'll train back and they get a great pump and stuff like that.
Yeah.
I would do all the heavy weights, but nothing would happen. I wouldn't be pumped or anything like that. Hmm. And it was just great to train with Justin and George and see the way George moves the weight and just try to emulate what George did. And I could tell you right now, like it's made a huge difference in the development that I've had over like my bodybuilding career.
Did you have to reduce the weight at all, or are you able to use the same weight and feel it better now?
Of course I had to. You know, George, when it comes to weight, he's a beast, man. Yeah. So I had to, like a lot of bodybuilders wouldn't do that, you know, but I actually had to humble myself and, you know, let him take the lead and, you know, follow what he does and follow what Justin says and just, you know, just be a student again and learn, you know?
Because, you know, I've been watching. I'm sorry.
That's the one thing I could tell you about Akim is that he's very, very open to learning, you know? Like, just like, I mean, I kind of approach what I do the same way. I'm always willing to learn, you know, and Akim has that same open mind, you know, and it's been helpful. And I've really, really seen a huge change, a huge progress in him, you know? Even like it's hard to explain it, but visually, like the way he moves the weights when he does back, the way he does the exercises, you could just see he has much more command now over his back than he did before. And yeah, and what was cool about Akim is because he's so big, you know, you would figure a guy like that, he's a big open bodybuilder about to win, you know, the Mr. Olympia, that would want to, you know, he'd want to put George, you know, the 212 guy in his place, but it wasn't like him. Humbled himself, actually used lighter weight just because I wanted him to connect with the muscles a little better, you know. But now he's using the same weight as George. He's up, you know, he's keeping up with George just fine now. Now that they're, you know, he's pushing George in certain things. So it's been a great pairing of those two. You know, and George is back, is getting better too. So Akim's been helping him, and he's been helping Akim.
Yeah, I mean, you talk about legs. Akim's legs are like, you know, after Rami, those are the freakiest legs to me in the world right now, Rami. But geez, Akim's not that far behind. You know, his quads they come out of nowhere. But, you know, his back, Akim, that's the one thing I've wanted to see for the last few years, because from the front, it's like, damn, you know, and some of the side shots, damn. But then you turn around and I'm like, it's like a little, it's just not matching everything else. So if that is coming up, if that's going to match the rest of you, and I think Justin knows how to get you dialed into some nasty condition. Good Lord, you know, I'd love to see you battling Rami in a few months, man. How awesome would that be?
Ron, I'm sure Akeem's going to tell you this, but the one thing I just want to say before I forget it is the biggest improvement in him has been his back. Not only the muscles are bigger and rounder, but oddly enough, like we were just talking about it actually earlier today, he sent me some progress photos. And what's weird is that his back is leaner than his hamstrings and his glutes.
Wow.
And then that's the opposite of what he's had in the past. So not only is he progressing when his muscles are getting bigger and he's getting stronger, but like, you know, his body's changing. His back is one of the most ripped parts on him right now.
That is encouraging to hear, because it wasn't just the development that I thought was lacking. It was from the front, I'd see all kinds of strike. I could see every freaking fiber and the quads and the everywhere was striated in detail, but then the back, I didn't see that. So if that quality has been added to the physique, Akim, you must be, you know, you still have work to do. I know we're not at the Olympia yet, but this must be encouraging, because I'm sure you've been hearing about your back for a very long time and how.
And I'm like you said, you know, I'm happy that I'm finally in a prep where my back is coming in before everything else. You know, I've never had that before. So that tells you, you know.
Yeah. Now you're in prep. What are you in prep for? Is it a secret? You can't tell us? Okay.
The plan right now is Chicago. Mm-hmm. But if, you know, like I said, if we're ahead and Justin likes the way I look, we might do something a little sooner than that.
Going through my schedule, I think the only thing sooner than that is Puerto Rico. I'm sorry. Yeah, it's the Puerto Rico Pro in the Bahamas. Nothing is where it's supposed to be.
What we kind of did, Ron, was we didn't pin down a specific show. You know, because it's our first time working together. I'm still learning his body. He's still learning, you know, me as a coach. And, you know, so instead of saying, okay, this is definitely what we're doing, you know, it's just about improvement and seeing when he's ready, you know, but he's coming in fast. So he could be ready for a show earlier, you know. But what's good is we have choices. There's that, and there's Chicago, there's Tampa, there's that new Texas show, I think Toronto. So, you know, it's not like we have to do any specific show. Right. You know, I asked, you know, when we started, I asked Akim, and he was like, look, I just want to qualify and get ready for the Olympia. He's not really looking at it like the qualifier is the important show. The important show is in October, and I agree with him.
Yeah, absolutely. Akim, tell me about how the condition and everything else, your headspace and your body condition at the start of this prep versus start of your last prep in 2020.
Well, I mean, for this prep, I was a lot before in the past. I was, I think we stayed a lot leaner this time around, and just, you know, the training with, you know, training with George and following Justin's lead in terms of what he wanted me to do for the back development and stuff like that. It paid a lot. It paid off a lot. And I was able to, like I said, make the improvements there, which is what I'm really happy with. You know, I've shown, you know, people like the owner of MHP, owner of Muscle Mass, the photos and stuff like that. And everybody agreed that this time around, you know, I've really made a lot of leaps and bounds in the back development.
Yeah. Because we're talking about Gerard, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, Gerard's very picky because he was a competitor himself. So I think he's not going to give you a compliment unless you really earned it. Unless he's really happy with what he's seen. Just getting to Muscle Mass for a second. Go ahead.
You're looking at Justin. Justin's been around George for God knows how long. Mm-hmm. So he sees back all the time. So, you know, he's not going to tell me something that's not true, you know.
True. How long you been with Muscle Meds now?
Oh, man. I want to say, God, since 2015, 2016.
Oh, wow. Okay.
It's been a while. I mean, yeah, I had a little bit of time with Blackstone Meds, but it's been a while, yeah.
Top three favorite products?
Amino Deconate. I love the Amino Glutamine. I mean, I have about four. The Stem Tropin is really great. It's one of my favorite products because I use it to get recovery for sleep and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Once I train hard, I take it right before I go to bed. And I really, really like the Nitro Test, which is the pre-workout.
Oh, right on. Okay. Justin, how do you feel about pre-workouts? I know it's kind of random, but do you like your athletes using them all the time, cycle them, or only on certain body parts?
I mean, it's cool, you know, whatever gets them going. What I care about, Ron, is that they come to the gym and train hard. So if they're taking a pre-workout and that's going to, you know, fire them up for the workout, I'm all for it. And it works good. I mean, I know, you know, Akim does his pre-workout and like George has his from, you know, he does his Redcon, but it's like, you know, yeah, I mean, it works on both of them. So why not? I mean, as long as you're not, you know, taking too much. I think the problem is people get overdone. They take too much pre-workout, but if you're taking the right amount, I think it only helps you, you know, gives you a little extra kick for the workout.
Yeah. Akim, you posted on your Instagram the other day, which is AkimBK_BeastWilliams. Is that right? Is that correct? You were talking about a new type of mask that you use because we still, in most states in the U.S. still have to wear a mask in the gym. And I'm sure New York is one of them. I think it's only Florida and Texas where you don't have to wear a mask, but how have you adapted to training in a mask? Because a lot of bodybuilders just hate it. They find it so constricting with the breathing and everything.
Well, I mean, one of the cool things about that mask, the Aeron mask, that's what it's called. It has a built-in fan that sucks it while you're working out and everything like that. And it's rechargeable. So you don't have to worry about, like, you know, you charge it every night or whatever. It works for like 6-7 hours. And like you get clean air while you're training and everything like that. So it's awesome. It's an awesome product, you know.
It's a fan inside the mask?
Yes, built-in fan that plugs in with it. And, you know, it keeps going while you're breathing in clean air while you're training. And it goes through a filter. So you just, like, whenever the filters get dirty, you just replace the filters and stuff like that. So it's a really cool product, you know.
You're winning the mask game, I'll tell you that. The rest of us are stuck with all these.
I mean, I got to give my little brother props for that, you know. It's family-owned product. My little brother designed it and everything like that. Oh, so wow. Props to that. Yeah.
It's definitely the fanciest mask I've ever seen.
Yeah. Justin got a look at it. And, you know, it's a really great product. It's a really great design mask, you know? Wow. So if anybody want to check it out, it's called an Air On mask, you know, has a little button, you press it, the fan starts sucking in the air and, you know, it's definitely a lot easier to breathe in that thing.
George can't wear it because he makes his own DeBull mask. He's not going to screw up his merchandise. I wouldn't. Okay. So the gym, Bevan, do you do most of your training at Bevan Steve's Powerhouse?
No, I usually go out there once a week. I wish I could go out there longer, but I live all the way in North Jersey, so it's a bit of a drive for me.
Yeah.
So, you know, I would go out there every Tuesday to train back with Justin and George. Yeah. So I wish I more often, but, you know, for now.
Seems like a lot of you guys in the New York, New Jersey area, whenever you want to go to a different gym, it's like hours. It's like,
yeah,
nothing's that. Yeah, the traffic must be horrific. Jeez. I mean,
we train at a time that is really good because we train at like 1 o'clock. Okay. So right around there, not a lot of time, but when we're finished and me heading back home, that's when the traffic is crazy.
Yeah. I'm going to go back to the Olympia again. I know I've probably asked this in a previous interview that we've done since then, but how much more confidence did it give you to know that you're at that next level now that you're up there with the top six guys where, you know, prior to that, you were fighting to be in the top 10. It was, you were lucky to get in the top 10, honestly, because it was, it's the toughest show in the world. These are the best physiques in the entire world. But now you're up in that very, very elite group. Did you get a lot of confidence from that show?
No, I mean, I wouldn't say that because I still was out of the top five.
Barely.
So kind of like, you know, it's just like, damn, like, you know, one more spot. So that's the way I kind of viewed it. Yeah. You know, I would have loved to have been in the top five, and I would have loved to take the whole year off and just prep for the Olympia. Mm. But, you know, the sad part is, you know, I got to go do another show and then qualify again to get back there. But to me, top six, getting that first, I was more like happy or more excited about being in that first call up. Like I said, you know, after that, you know, got sixth place, I'm happy with it, you know, because it's a start, it's like a step in the right direction. Yeah. But if I had gotten in that top five, I would have been like, you know.
How many points were separated you and Bonac?
I am not sure. I never really looked at the scorecard to really find out.
I'll have to investigate. I bet it was like 2 points or something. Because, man, I could have flip-flopped you guys. No disrespect to William, but you're, you know, very different physiques, both great in their own way. So, yeah, I honestly think the judges have, especially at that level, that's one of the hardest jobs in the world because they can't win. No matter what placings they put, they can't win. Although I think the Rami was kind of a, I don't think too many people argued with the Rami win situation, but after that, people are like, no, Pete should have been way down here and this should have been, you know, nobody's happy. So we're in May now, we're almost into June in a couple of weeks. So the Olympia is coming up. What type of improvements, you know, we talked about the back, but overall, I'll start with you, Justin. What improvements do you want to see on stage in Akim at this Olympia versus last time we saw him?
Bigger back, leaner back, better presentation, you know, but I mean, just better overall, you know, like, look, when I was, and I've been watching, and I've been telling Akim for years, look, you're Mr. Olympia. You know, I've been, every time I saw him, I would be like, you know, hey, you can beat all of these guys. Cause it's true. It's obvious. It's like, you know, a little bit about bodybuilding and you watch, you know, the potential's all there. Yeah. You know, it's funny. You asked Akim about how, you know, if he's happy that he was in the top call out and all that. And, you know, I know he's not satisfied with that. And even me, like, as just a outsider at the time, I'm friendly, you know, at the time with Akim watching last year's Olympia, but, you know, not super good friends, right?
Yeah.
But, I'm a fan of his physique, and he's a nice guy and everything, and I've known Oscar for years, so it was I was rooting for those guys. But when I saw Akim get called out, I was like, cool, this is where he belongs, you know? But in looking at him on stage next to these guys, my only thought was, he can win this show. I mean, when I look at it and I'm like a little bit of tweaks here and there, I mean, who's big enough to stand next to Rami? Maybe Rolly and Akim.
Yeah. I mean, there's only a few guys now. There's not that many big heavy guys anymore. They're like they were years ago. It's crazy.
No one's big enough. Yeah. But he is. I mean, and the craziest shit about him, Ron, is that, like, you know, it's funny. We had a discussion because I'm always like trying to get guys to lose a certain amount of weight each week as they're going into the show.
Yeah.
And I just find it helps, you know, dial that conditioning in. And Akim was telling me, he's like, yeah, but I don't think that'll work for me because I don't lose weight really going into the shows. I add muscle and lean out at the same time.
Wow.
And I was like, okay, well, fair enough. You know, but I'm watching it. And like, he scared me the other day. He was like, hey, listen, you know, I'm a little like, I feel a little watery. And he, you know, he expressed his concern.
Yeah.
And I'm like, okay. And I was like, what's your weight? He goes, well, I gained 3 pounds. So I was like, fuck, why, you know, all right. You know, why did he gain weight? And I told him, I was like, all right, he had me a little concerned, but then he came in the next day to Bev's and he was a few pounds heavier. He went from high 270s into low 280s.
Wow.
But he was much leaner. I posted a video on Instagram of him hitting a lat spread. Like, he wasn't that lean the week before, 3 pounds lighter. So, I mean, this guy's growing. And I don't really feed him that much, you know?
Hmm. Has it always been that way, Akim? Have you always grown into shows?
Yeah.
Hmm. Well, you know, I'm going to throw a theory out there. You can shoot it down in 2 seconds. A lot of guys don't eat that much in the off season. Mm-hmm. Versus prep, but when prep, because it's more structured, now they have meal 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, And then you see these guys packing on muscle, even though they're getting lean. Do you eat more during prep than you do in the off season?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Like a lot more?
A lot more, yeah.
There you go. Because, man, I mean, to hear that you're growing, that's crazy. Because, I mean, how bigger can this freaking guy get, for God's sake?
When we started training together, you know, that's what I went over his diet. I said, what are you doing? He's like, well, you know, I'm eating, you know, my three meals and this. And I said, but he has a hard time getting more than three meals in the off season at certain junctures, you know, and that's where he was at. Mm-hmm. But it was amazing when I saw him, how big he was. Mm-hmm. And I was like, well, if he's this big on three meals, what's he going to be like as he gets into prep and starts eating more? And sure enough, he's growing into the prep on restricted calories, you know?
Wow. Akim, a lot of guys just got really upset hearing that you only eat three meals a day in the off season. Like, I remember the only time I think people get more angry was Max Charles was claiming to eat one meal a day. Remember that? But anyway, another New Yorker.
I'm telling you, if someone said, all right, who's the craziest genetic bodybuilders you've ever met in your 25 years around the sport? I would say Akim and Max.
Wow.
Because it's true. They don't eat and they're 300 pounds and crazy looking. It's like, you know, most people can't do that.
Well, I'm assuming, Akim, if you're eating three times a day, they were big, big meals, weren't they?
No, not at all. Not at all. In the offseason, I just don't have an appetite. Wow.
But Ron, you got to understand, we're talking about a guy that won an overall title in bodybuilding less than a week after a lady met him on a bus and told him he should go and compete in the show. He shaved with no coloring on. With no diet, with no cardio, 6 months after he started weight training and won an overall. And my friend, we were in the gym talking about it the other day. my friend Tony, who's competed in over 300 shows, all right? He's an amateur bodybuilder.
God, 300.
He's one of those guys. He just did show after show. Every show I've ever been to over the last 20 years, Tony was in it. Hmm. And he happened to be there. We were talking. Tony goes, hey, that's true. He goes, I was backstage. I remember talking to him. And him telling me, yes, I met some lady on a bus last week and she told me to do the show.
Yeah. Well, to clarify, it wasn't just some lady. Older people, you know, the young kids have no idea who Leon Brown is, but Leon right. Brown was one of the best amateur bodybuilders. Did he turn? I think he was a pro, wasn't he? Did he turn pro?
Yeah, he did get his pro card. I think he competed as pro for a little bit. Yeah.
He's in the movie Pumping Iron. In the there's a scene where they had a contest in Massachusetts, actually, that he did all the shows in the East Coast for years and years, but he was I think he was out in California, trained with Arnold and those guys for a while too. So that's whose wife saw you and saw. How did she even see the potential? Were you in like a tank top or something?
Yeah, I was just coming home from working out. I think it was. I was getting home and I had a tank top on. Yeah. And at that time they still had Metro cards and stuff in the city, so I was trying to put a Metro card inside the spot or whatever. And when I'm walking back, she taps me and she's like, "Come here for a second." So I'm like, man, is this lady trying to kick game to me? Yeah. But I just wanted to tell me about bodybuilding.
Wow. Because you're Justin, you know, you've been around a very long time and you have the eye for physiques. And people with awesome genetics, you and I, we could spot them a mile away. You could have a gym with 100 people training and you'd be like, that guy or that girl right there. They just stand out above everybody else. It's a different, the structure, the way the muscles are shaped, everything's very, very different. And these guys, these guys are all at the elite level, but this is another level of genetic gifts.
That's how George got into it. He was just weightlifting in the gym. And some guy came up to him. He said, "Oh, do you compete?" And George is like, "Compete in what?" He said, "Bodybuilding." You know? So yeah, it's like the, you know, look, I think you can do anything you want, Ron, in life. I think that, you know, you can will yourself to change and change your body and morph into whatever way you really want.
Yeah.
But I think truly great bodybuilders are born, yeah. You know, like, I mean, then you get someone like Akim or like George who has that work ethic on top of having, you know, a great genetics for it. And that's when you get guys who become Mr. Olympia.
Right. Akim, I'm curious, have you ever met somebody with genetics you thought were at least close to yours who just never went anywhere because they didn't have the drive or, you know, maybe their life circumstances? Because I've seen people with genetics that I thought were spectacular, but there was something prevented them either in their own mind or in their own or their personal life or something. Have you known people like that?
I mean, I'm from the Caribbean, so back in my mom's country, Grenada, I have this one cousin. His name is David, and this kid growing up, he was just so built. Never touched weight in his life, but he was just built. So I'm, you know, thinking back now, I'm like, man, if this kid ever like lifted weights or something like that, yeah. it would be scary. Because yeah. just as a kid, he was just so built, you know.
You're right, because I went to that Caribbean. The IFBB Caribbean and Central American Championships, I went to it twice. Once in Costa Rica, Nicaragua, mm-hmm. El Salvador. It was El Salvador, and then I went in Jamaica. And mm-hmm. when I was in there in Jamaica, we were doing like, people were doing photo shoots on the beach, and this guy was walking by, and I said, how'd you do in the show? He goes, what show? I said, the show last night. He goes, what do you mean? I said, the Caribbean. He goes, no. I said, do you lift it all? He goes, no. And this guy was, he wasn't like, Akim, he wasn't your size, but he'd probably be instantly classic Z pro like that right then and there. So yeah, I mean, I think it's the diet, the genetics, it's a lot of factors, but you see people, the Caribbean, I think, has some of the most spectacular genetics in the entire world, I think.
Rob, Max Charles would tell me that people would always stop his father and say, hey, you know, do you compete? And he's like, what do you mean? Are you a bodybuilder? He's like, no. I was like, oh, wow. I was like, he was into weightlifting, no, Max? He said, no.
I mean, Akim, where in your family? Is it your mom? Is it your dad? Did it skip a generation? Does anybody else in your family muscular?
I have one of my aunts who actually did bodybuilding before.
Oh, wow. Okay.
One of my aunts on the other side who actually did bodybuilding. She competed as a female bodybuilder.
Wow. How'd she do?
I recently started learning about it. So I'm guessing she did okay.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, this was probably, it down in Grenada?
Yeah, it was down in the Caribbean,
It's probably not a lot of shows, so.
Yeah.
Yeah. Wouldn't get a lot of notoriety. Plus, there was no internet back then, so.
Yeah.
She couldn't rack up 300,000 followers on Instagram like you could today. That's one thing I want to ask you about. You know, both of you guys, social media has really, George talked about it in an interview I saw a little while ago. You have to be very active on social media. You have to be. The sponsors expect it. It's just part of your own. It's part of the career now. How do you balance producing enough content and taking pictures and making all these posts with also being able to concentrate as well as you need to be the best bodybuilder you can be?
In the beginning of when this whole social media started, you know, I used to try really hard to like just get content and put content out and stuff like that, and just do stuff for social media, you know, like do like crazy lifts and all this other stuff just to get like likes and comments on social media. But now I'm at this point where, like, you know, if I feel like posting a video, I'll post a video, you know. If I think it's something interesting that somebody could learn something from, then I'll post it and stuff like that. So I don't really do it for like comments or like likes and stuff like that anymore. Sure, you know, I still, you know, have to, it's my job to promote the products and stuff like that, but when it comes to like videos and stuff like that, I kind of like do it more as an educational, you know.
Do you think people are hurting themselves? Because I see people doing deadlifts with their backs rounded, and I see some very cringy things. And I know they're just doing it because they're posting it.
Yeah.
I can't imagine if nobody was going to see it outside the gym, they would even bother. But it creeps me out. I'm like, this guy's going to blow his back out. We just saw that poor guy tear his pec, and I'm not saying he was doing a stunt lift, but geez, that was the craziest pec tear I've ever seen. Him, that Ryan guy. Did you see it?
Yeah.
I'm sure. I'm sure if he was on camera, he probably wouldn't have been lifting like that. Yeah. You know, the camera plays a part in it, man. You know.
Yeah. You know, and you've talked about this in interviews we've done over the past year or two. Is you've actually stepped away from the super super heavy lifting because when we first started doing interviews years ago, you were going very low on the reps. I remember. Like 3 to 5 rep sets weren't uncommon for you at all. You don't do that anymore, right?
Anymore, no. Yeah. To be honest with you, I can't remember the last time I actually stepped under the bar with like 500 pounds and squatted. Mm-hmm. You know, I'll say it like 4 or 5 reps and stuff like that. You know, I just, you know, you just change your whole mindset, you know. I don't have anything to prove to anybody, you know. Like I said, squatting all that weight is not going to make me look better on stage. You know, nobody cares about how much you squat. You know, they care about how your legs look. You know, so if I can make my legs look like I squat 500 pounds and do 315, then why not do it, you know?
Justin, I got to hear your take on that because I know there are coaches that they really do believe their athletes have to train like Ronnie Coleman if they're going to be the best they can be. They go, you don't get muscle, you don't get that dense look unless you're doing 500 pound bench and 800 pound squats. And I got to hear Justin Miller's take.
My take on that, Ron, is that if that works for a particular coach or a particular athlete, and that's what they want to do, then more power to them. Mm-hmm. You know, I think that as a coach too, I talked before about it, you know, Akim said he was open to learning. I'm always open to learning as a coach. And I think one thing that over the years, you know, you see enough injuries, you see Ryan tear his pec, you see different things happen, you know, to people. And, you know, you start to question it. You know, I've had this conversation with George over the last couple of years where we actually sat down. It was actually two people at the gym who my wife actually told me, she overheard the conversation. They were talking shit about George and me, the way he trains, because, you know, he trains really heavy and, you know, so and so. And there's two guys that are, you know, been around the sport and they're older and they probably had some injuries, right? Yeah. Yeah. And they were like, you know, talking shit about the way George trains and the way I train George, because he's very strong and lifts heavy weights. And, you know, instead of blowing it off and saying, oh, well, screw those guys or whatever, I thought about it, you know, and not that that was what made me think about it, but it's just one thing that comes to mind. Yeah. And, you know, George and I had many conversations. I said, George, I want to bring something up to you. You know, what do you think about the idea of purposely not training as heavy? You know, not lifting as much weight, if we focus more on time under tension, on rep speeds, on different combinations of exercises and different things like that to minimize risk. And, you know, he was open to that. And we just to, you know, put more emphasis on it. I mean, look, as all bodybuilders feel what they're doing, usually they don't just throw weight typically, right?
Yeah.
But there are two different sports. You got powerlifting and you got bodybuilding. And in powerlifting, the objective is to see how much weight you can lift. Mm. The muscle size you build from that is really a side effect in a sense of the training. Just in like bodybuilding, the goal is to get bigger muscles. And the weight that you can lift is kind of a side effect of that goal.
Right.
So, you know, I changed it. I changed my philosophy, not only on George, but on everybody. And Akim had some experiences, I know, had long conversations with Akim about it, where he had experiences that were scares that made him step back. I mean, there's video of Akim squatting over 800 pounds, right. You know, but just because he can do that doesn't necessarily mean that that's what's going to win him an Olympia title. Because if you look at the past champions, and that was part of my conversation with George, I said, well, how many people were squatting, you know, over 500 pounds for reps, you know, as they were preparing for the Mr. Olympia that actually won the title? And the only one we could come up with was Ronnie Coleman.
Right.
And there's been a lot of Olympia champions, you know, but they weren't training that way. Maybe they were very strong at one point, but for the most part, when they came to that point in their career where they were getting ready to win an Olympia or defend Olympia titles, you know, they weren't doing that. They weren't training as heavy as they could. They were more focused on the form and the feel. And honestly, there's a longevity aspect to this, Ron. If you talk to, you know, I always pick the brain of like former great bodybuilders or great coaches or great, you know, champions or whatever. And most of them will tell you, hey, look, I got to a point in my career where I decided to train for longevity, not for power, not for the number, since my goal was being a better bodybuilder and building bigger muscles. You know, it's more about the longevity of the sport, because the longer you can compete, the more success you can have. You know, if Akeem's done in 2 years, he can only win 2 Olympia titles. Yeah. You know, if he competes for another 7, you know, then he's one shy of a record.
Akim, you're still a young guy too. What are you, like 34?
I wish, man, 36.
Like, that's that much old. You're talking to someone who's pushing 52. But I'm curious, Akim, all those weights, you know, I saw you do some crazy lifts on videos. Did you escape harm-free, or did you tweak anything in those years when you're doing all that?
I mean, I've always had like a little bit of shoulder problem. That's why I don't really bench as heavy as I used to. Mm-hmm. But as far as like the knees and stuff like that, my knees are fine. You know, I could squat heavy still, you know.
Yeah.
But I just choose to rather do 4 or 5 for reps and just, you know, strict form and control the weight and just make the, you know, make the weight heavy, so to speak.
Yeah.
Use lightweight and make it feel heavy, you know. Like you said, it's more for longevity, you know, and I feel I feel like me doing that, my legs actually look better now than when I was squatting 700-800 pounds.
You know? I can tell you, you know, I remember you, your first pro win, I think was it 2017 or 18?
Yeah, 2017, I think it was. 2017
Tampa. I mean, the muscle quality from then to now, the separation, the detail has drastically improved. I have to think that that's played it. That's a big reason why, because even back then I was thinking this guy doesn't need to be any bigger. He just needs to refine all that mass. Cause good Lord, the size and the shape, it's all there. The structure, the crazy X frame. If he could just slice all that up and carve in a bunch of fine details, it'd be game over. And we're headed in that direction right now. It looks like.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, Ron, you know, it's what builds bigger muscles? Is it just lifting heavier weights? I say no. I mean, yeah, all right, I get the whole progressive overload principle theory, you know, and that's true. But I've seen guys, I've trained guys and girls who built bigger muscles using less weight. Matter of fact, when George and I made that shift where we didn't purposely train as heavy and we used other intensity boosters, his physique and his improved, his muscles grew, you know? So I've seen it firsthand. And I think that if the amount of weight you lifted mattered that much in bodybuilding, then the best power lifters in the world would be the best bodybuilders.
Yeah.
But they're not.
Allow me to tell one quick story. The 2000, I won't say the show, I don't want to put this guy on blast, but we're all backstage, we're in the heavyweight class and everyone's talking. And this guy was talking, he was a nationally ranked power lifter. And he was talking about, he's got a squat. I think his squat was like, it might've been as much as 800 pounds. It was at least 700, whatever it was. I was like, oh my God, I can't wait to see this guy's legs. And then when he finally took off the sweats and started pumping up, I was like, huh, that's it? I thought he was going to have these freaking Tom Platz legs. And I'm like, my legs are way bigger than his. I don't get it. Because I've never squatted more than, I've never done good reps for like more than 405, 455 in my life. And I expect it. But that's, it's a common misconception. I'm glad you guys have talked about that, because I go out of my mind all day on Instagram watching these kids with the one rep deadlifts and the one rep squats, and I don't know what they're thinking, but enough about that. So
I'd rather focus on helping these athletes preserve themselves and have a longer, more successful career rather than increasing the risk of injury. It's there anyway, but to push it and to lift as much as you can all the time, and I just feel like your risk goes up. I'd rather have them get better and focus on longevity aspects, you know?
Yeah, I mean, like for example, you know, you look at somebody like Larry Wills, who's super strong with squats, like his squats, his deadlift is insane. And, you know, he don't have Rami's legs, you know?
Yeah.
You would think he's squatting 900 pounds or whatever the case may be, you know, his legs will be as big as Rami, but no, you know, he don't have the same kind of legs like Rami has. Yeah. So it tells you something about, you know, the way to build muscle, you know, is you don't always have to use the heavy weights to try to build the muscle that you want to build, the quality of the muscle and stuff like that, you know?
Yeah.
So it's two different sports, Ron. They're related, but they're two different sports.
In a lot of people's minds, they're kind of one and the same, unfortunately. But let's talk. The last thing I want to talk about is plans for conditioning, because, you know, I see Akim's condition has gotten better and better in the past. You know, I saw it. What Toronto show? Was it 2019, Akim, that you almost won? It was like a one. Was it you and Juan were like 1 point apart? I think it was 2019.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's when I first saw you condition at a level I was like, wow, finally he's getting there. And then last year it went up another notch. Yeah, what do you guys have planned for this year to improve even more on that condition where it's just crazy?
Just from my standpoint, it's just building on what he's already done. I mean, from an outside perspective, I wasn't there, you know, but just from my discussions with Akim, you know, like I think that what's helped him is not gaining so much weight and size in the off season, because he showed me pictures where he was, what, became 325 pounds with 25 inch arms, Ron, if you can believe that.
Oh, I believe it. I believe it. I've stood next to this guy. I believe it.
But I mean, he's only right now he's heavier than he was when we first started training. But he looks totally different, you know, but I think that keeping leaner in the off season is a big key. I think it helps him a lot. Because then you have less distance to travel. It's like starting a marathon at the 26-mile mark, or, you know, starting it at the 13-mile mark. I think it's much less effort and exhaustion, you know, running 13 miles as opposed to 26.
True. Yeah. You know, the one thing
that's part of it.
212 and classic guys generally come in on average better condition than the open body builders. And I think it's because most of them really have to struggle to get to a certain weight or else they're not going to be allowed to compete. Whereas in the open, there's no, they don't get weighed. So some guys, they decide I'm going to come in bigger and fuller, or maybe their coaches make that call. And you don't see the quality condition in the open. Justin and Akim, how do you guys deal with that when you don't have a weight that you necessarily have to get to?
I'm learning. I'm learning as I go. I mean, you know, with Akim, he's an individual, just like George is an individual, just like any bodybuilder is an individual. And it goes back to that conversation I had with him where, you know, I tend to do things, all right, let's lose a couple pounds this week. And he was like, he stopped me. He goes, no. He's like, I can't do that because, you know, my condition will improve, but my weight won't change.
Wow.
So I'm learning to adapt, you know, my coaching style with Akim to fit Akim. And you're right. I think that a lot of the classic guys and 212 guys are, you know, forced in a sense to get ripped because, like George, for example, you know, he looked good last year, you know, but he wasn't as ripped in the last Olympia, and there's different factors in that, but as he was the year before, part of it was that he was ripped 10 pounds over the weight class. Whereas we had a little room to play last year and, you know, just different things didn't work out quite as well as we wanted. But now I got no choice. You know, George will be ripped at about, I don't know, I mean, 225. Mm-hmm. So he's forced to do that. So in a sense, it's kind of like mistake proof, you know, he's got to get shredded to the bone to make the weight, right. You know, whereas in the open, I think the guys, look, let's face it, they're judged on muscle.
Right.
It's not a conditioning contest. You know, it's a muscle, you know, it's a bodybuilding contest. You know, I wouldn't say that Big Rami was the most ripped guy on the stage, but he was the biggest, you know.
Okay,
condition. So I feel like it's a combination for the open. You can't just focus on condition and lose muscle. You got to bring in the most muscle that you can with the best condition.
What I was in terms of what you just said, like me and Justin, we just posed on Tuesday at Bev's, and like the little video that he posted, and the way I look from behind, I usually look like that, like 2 weeks out from a show.
Wow.
And that would be like, okay, my back is looking good. Like I would be happy with that. And just to hear him say like, no, we need to get shredded. It's just like, okay, like the bar has been like raised, like, you know? So that definitely like motivated me to like, okay, this is not good enough. This is not nowhere near good enough, like to his standards. Yeah. We have to keep pushing, you know?
Yeah.
So that has definitely motivated me to like, okay, we got to get more conditioned. We got to get leaner and stuff like that. So I really like that. I really appreciate him like looking at me and saying like, nah, we got to get conditioned.
So that was, you're at least, how many, we haven't picked a show yet, but you're at least 10 weeks out from the first possible show?
Yeah.
So that's very encouraging to hear.
I'm looking at, like, the way I look right now, it would look like about, like, I'm, like, 2 weeks out from a show in the past.
There you have it.
Okay. So that tells you something.
Yeah.
As far as my back is concerned, that tells you something.
And the key for me, Ron, is not resting on that. Like Akim just said, in a sense, I'm such a pain in the ass with condition. We had to raise the bar, you know? But that's what it's about. But I'm also working with him in that, you know, and I promise him we're not going to lose any muscle, you know? Mm. He's adding muscle, so losing it, I think, is just basically impossible at this point. But I'm mindful of that. It's not just condition. You know, it's making sure that Akim comes in with not only all his muscle he has now, but all the muscle that he can have for the show. You know, because no one's seen the most muscular version of Akim yet, I'll tell you that.
Hmm.
You know, certainly not the most conditioned. I mean, in my opinion, if Akim's ripped as ripped, if he's the most ripped guy on stage, he wins. Who beats him? Tell me somebody that beats Akim if he's the most ripped guy on the stage. I'll wait.
Man, I guess if Rami was like 99.9% as ripped, maybe, I don't know. That's the only guy I think would push him.
Everybody, who beats him?
Yeah, I'm thinking. I come up with nothing. I got nobody.
So, like, that's the goal, but I also at the same time want to make sure that he's happy with the level of muscle that he has. Because, all right, fine, he was 265 for the Olympia. Who's saying he can't be 280 for the Olympia this year? You know, I'm not saying that he will be.
Right. Right.
But what I'm saying is I'm open to that. If he's shredded to the bone and he's 280, then what's the problem?
Yeah.
I mean, you know, but I'm pushing him with that condition because I think it'll a little more condition in the right spots will make all the difference.
Yeah. Well, this is exciting. I mean, it's cool to see people that even as recently as 2 or 3 years ago, they weren't on the radar to be Mr. Olympia. Like if you had said, what do you think about Akim as Mr. Olympia 3 years ago? I guarantee most fans would be like, no, come on. He's good. He ain't that good. But now.
Ron, you've been around this thing as long as me, right? Longer. Yeah. So let me ask you a question. If somebody said to you in 1997, hey, the next Mr. Olympia is going to be Ronnie Coleman, what would you have said?
You're on crack.
If you went back and look at his physique,
yeah,
he was fucking close. It was just like all my friends that have nothing to do with bodybuilding, they like work out and stuff. We'd watch those Battle for the Olympia videos. And my friends, that they'd be like, well, how come this guy isn't winning? The guy from Texas is huge.
Mm.
But it was like he needed that extra little bit of condition. It wasn't much,
yeah,
but it was enough to move him from ninth to first.
Yeah. Well, I remember at the Arnold in 96 or 95. I think it was 95 or 96. He wasn't as big then. He got bigger, a little bigger, obviously.
Right. Yeah.
But everybody was working out at that World Gym downtown. And I saw him, he was squatting in a corner. I was like, damn. That guy, Ronnie Coleman, he's really good. Why isn't he winning shows? I think he just won his first show, like in Montreal or something. But like, he should be up there with like Flex Wheeler and Dorian and those guys. Because at the time, I think he was, you know, like a 12th, 10th or 12th place Olympia guy. So, yeah, I mean.
It's a subtle conditioning difference that pushed him over the top.
Yeah. And that's.
More muscle, but he improved his condition a little bit and boom, he was unbeatable. I feel like it's the same thing here.
Yeah.
Similar. Different people, but you know.
It's the same thing we're saying about Rami for years. And this is what I say about Akim. I say more conditioning, get that back thicker, more detailed, and lights out, game over. So
yes, sir.
Exciting stuff. Well, guys, I'm going to wrap it up. I appreciate you guys taking the time. Olympia's not that far away. It's coming right up, and we got another show that you'll qualify at. So you guys don't have that long to wait to see the new and improved version of Akim. I'm certainly very anxious to see what you guys have in store for us. So keep working hard, guys. We're all anxious to see the finished product.
Oh, thank you so much, Ron.
You're welcome.
Thanks, Ron. Appreciate you having us.
Ronline Report. This has been me with Akim Wiliams and Justin Miller. Thanks for watching. See you next time.